everyone, and welcome back to another episode of the Passive Income Through Multifamily Real Estate Podcast. I'm your co-host, Lolita, also joined by Kyle. Before we get started, please make sure to head over to our website, aptcapitalgroup.com, and grab our free Passive Investors Guide. Also, if you're interested in learning more about what we do, you can schedule a call with Kyle on our website as well. All right, now time to get into our show. On today's show, I'd like to give a warm welcome back to Neal Bawa. Neal, it's certainly a pleasure to have you back on. How are you?
Fantastic. Thanks for having me back on the show. Very excited.
Great. Glad to have you. Listeners, in case you missed it, back on episode 55 is where Neal shares how he uses data to develop one of the most successful companies in the industry. Now, today's episode will focus on current events and specifically the impact of coronavirus on real estate. So before we get started, Neal, could you please take it from here and tell the listeners a little bit more about yourself and what you currently do?
Sure. I am a geek, a nerd, a data scientist, computer science background. Accidentally blundered my way into real estate because I was given the job of building a campus from scratch for my technology company. And over the course of breaking lots of things over a year, learned lots of things about real estate and new construction, and got the bug from then onwards, and then used data science to figure out how to invest in the best cities and neighborhoods in the United States. We now have a portfolio of about 270 million. We have about 500 investors that are invested into it. A portfolio is in 9 states. Half of it is multifamily value adds, and the other half is multifamily new construction. We also have self-storage projects, and hopefully in the future, adding industrial to that mix. So hopefully we get a chance to talk about that today when we talk about COVID.
Perfect. Well, I'm excited for this interview because I think we interviewed like 2 months ago on the Friday episode, and you said one thing. You said you need to use the data to have the courage to walk away from a market that you enjoy. And I think now more than ever, you're going to start to see some markets falter and you may have to pivot a little bit. So if you can give a general overview of what you think COVID's done to the real estate industry as a whole, and then we'll kind of dig into multifamily and maybe industrial and some other things.
Sounds good. I think that this is a true black swan event. And I also believe that a lot of the effect of COVID hasn't been felt yet. One of the challenges is, you know, I like to ask trivia questions, right? So, you know, we had a recession, a real estate recession in 2008, but any guesses as to when the real estate market actually bottomed, you know?
I don't think it was till a couple of years later, right? 2009?
Most people think it's 9. I hear people saying 10. The market, the real estate market bottomed out in the first quarter of 2012, which was 4 years and 3 months after the recession started. Real estate has the longest lag time of any major industry because of, you know, laws against, you know, evictions, because of, you know, these states that where stuff just drags on for years and years. So it takes a very, very long time for impact to happen to us. Now, this time things were a little bit different because our rents got impacted, you know, immediately. Our occupancy got impacted. Delinquency certainly got impacted because of, you know, inability of certain people to pay. But even considering that, it takes a long time for real estate impact to come through. Let's assume that there's an apartment complex out there today where 20% of the tenants are not paying and the apartment complex was not very profitable to begin with. Maybe they overpaid and now they're upside down. Well, it's going to take them a while, 3 to 6 months, to burn through their reserves. Guess what they're going to do then? They're not going to hand over the keys to the bank. They're going to go back to their investors. They're going to do a cash call. And because, you know, they're already 80%+ occupied, maybe even 90%. Then they have the hopes of becoming positive. Their investors will give them some money, and that money will tide them over for 3 to 6 months. They might get more forbearance from their lender. They might try and refinance and go to a different lender at a higher rate. And so they have some choices. So I think that they don't really run out of choices this year. They run out of choices next year. Mm-hmm. And some of these scenarios are actually much longer than this. You can do multiple cash calls. So there might be apartment complexes that, you know, get sold at a discount 2 years from now because of what is happening today. And that's actually fairly normal. So the first thing I want to tell you about the impact is, this is the tip of the iceberg, and you're not even seeing the whole tip yet. Because of the way that real estate works, there is a very substantial lag.
So in your opinion, just let's talk about multifamily specifically here. What do you see the next 5 years?
Well, I see rent growth to be negative this year. I think that we've already seen that Class C is very slightly negative, 0.2%. Class B and A are about 0.5% negative in rent, which no big deal, right? But obviously it affects our underwriting, it affects our valuations, it affects everything where, you know, before we're thinking 2-3% rent growth, now we're looking at, you know, decline in rent. I see rents being slightly positive next year, but the first half of the year might be slightly negative, and then the second half of the year might be, you know, fairly positive. So overall, you're a bit positive. But I don't think we get back to 2-3% rent growth until 2022. So, and it might even be longer than that. So I think the impact is substantial and it is long-term. Having said that, there is now no doubt in my mind, and I had doubt 2 months ago, by the way, when last time you and I were talking, Kyle, I had doubt. I don't have any doubt that this asset class is affected less than anything else out there. Because yesterday I saw the Fannie Mae, or maybe it was Freddie Mac, advisory on delinquency, right? Which asset classes are delinquent? As you can imagine, the hotels and the retail, I mean, that's just going to be a bloodbath. But amongst the other asset classes, offices had a high, all asset classes had an increase in delinquency, but multifamily was already at an extremely low base of delinquency. There's almost no delinquency anywhere in the country in terms of, and when I say delinquency, I mean lenders not getting paid, right? So owners not paying the, you know, their payments. There was almost nothing. It was about 1% of the properties nationwide were late on payments. And now in 2 months, it's ticked up to like 1.3. I mean, that's a very, very small increase given just how devastating the last 3 or 4 months have been. So that's a positive sign. Industrial was the only one that did better than multifamily. It was already coming off an extremely low, you know, late payment base, and the delinquency didn't pick up very much. But office assets, student housing assets, senior housing assets all had very substantial increases in delinquency already. And as I said, we're just at the beginning of this process. So I think multifamily as an asset class comes out stronger from this recession than it did going into it. It comes out stronger because the world has now realized that need-based assets like multifamily cannot be looked at the same way as want-based assets like retail or hotel. I've always, and I've said this lots of times, you know, before 2018, 19, there have been days when people have asked me about hotels and retail and why I don't do this. And my answer has always been, I've always felt that investors don't understand risk when they invest in a hotel, when they invest in retail. They don't understand that these assets are priced at the same or similar cap rates as multifamily, but they are not integral to our economy, right? Lots and lots of these could go out of business at any point of time, and it's easy for that to happen, very easy for that to happen, and you just saw it happen in the last 3 or 4 months. So I think what is happening is there's going to be a class of investors who are like, oh, I'm going to invest in hotels, and I'm going to invest in retail, I'm going to invest in this and that. Now all of those people are realizing, crap, there's problems with that, mm-hmm. right? And so the demand for cash flowing occupied multifamily in the long run is going to get a tremendous boost from the coronavirus. Having said that, none of that is going to prevent rents from falling this year. None of that is going to prevent occupancy from falling this year, because occupancy decline doesn't really start until August, because unemployment benefits don't, you know, finish until the end of July. So people are getting free money right now. Of course, they're paying rent. We'll see the actual impact when we come out of the fake economy and get into a true economy in August. Now that might get extended because now they're thinking about another stimulus check. So, you know, who knows when this dance ends. But you don't have a real economy right now. So you can't really look at your occupancy numbers right now and give yourself a pat on the back. It doesn't mean anything, right? We'll give ourselves a pat on the back if our occupancy looks like this in November, mm-hmm. right? But I don't think it will. Every white paper that I read, when I see advisories from Greystone, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, everyone is declining across the board an occupancy decline. Now on the Class C side, it seems like it's the smallest decline, but there's a significant delinquency increase on the Class C side in the coming months. When people don't have money. They don't have money. I mean, it's not like the Class B, Class A guys that have $10,000 or $20,000 in the bank and they pay for 3 or 4 months before they stop paying. The C guys, the moment they don't have money, they just stop paying. Yeah. So you're going to see delinquency increases. So we're nowhere near the bottom of the net operating income hole here. We've just started to go into that. So none of that, in the short term, there's no good news to share for multifamily except, it. You know, if I wanted to say this, the sky really didn't fall on us, right? Because there were people predicting, oh, you know, 40% of our money would not come in. And that certainly didn't happen. It wasn't 40, it wasn't 30. It might've been, you know, a smaller number depending upon which property you were in. So overall, I'm very happy. You know, I'm close to my best case scenario. Well, 3 months ago when I was looking at best case, okay, and worst case didn't happen, middle case didn't happen. This is close to best case scenario. That's where we are. But the damage to the economy from COVID has been absolutely colossal, in many ways, far greater than the 2008 recession. And as a result, we are all going to suffer. Anybody that has an apartment complex that's a B or C, A, doesn't matter. We're going to suffer for the next 6 to 12 months. Mm-hmm. But in many ways, COVID makes our exits in 2022, 2023, 2024 better. Because in the long run, you might see cap compression. You might see multifamily assets becoming more expensive when people realize just how well they perform during a black swan event. Because of the financialization of the world economy, black swan events are going to come faster and faster. And now people are like, holy crap, look at the difference between these two asset classes during bad times, right? And so that gives us an inherent advantage because we have truly proven ourselves in the last 3 months.
Yeah. I'm a big believer that September through February are going to be very much of a struggle because when you get into the winter months, you know, people want to buy presents or they got to pay for rent and they're going to choose presents most of the time in a Class B and C environment. And so it's going to be even more difficult during that time. And it's a much slower time to lease up. So it'll be really interesting to see what happens. So what are you doing with your properties right now, knowing that, I mean, you just said it, that those months are going to be a struggle. Are you continuing with renovations? Are you kind of just trying to fill up occupancy? What are some strategies you're using right now?
We are just focused on occupancy at this point. Our goal is to get better tenant quality. We're not looking to raise rents. We've even cut rents in a couple places because we want to get a quality tenant in and we want our occupancy to be as high as possible. Yes, some of those people will stop paying at some point in the future. The other thing that we're doing is by boosting occupancy now, we're boosting profits, but we're not giving any money to our investors. We stopped giving money in March. So given nothing bad has happened yet, each month, our kitty is getting bigger, mm-hmm. right? We have more money in the bank. And the short answer is that money in the bank is what's going to protect us when stuff really starts to go wrong in that September to Feb timeframe. I think by March, the US economy will be booming. I am very bullish on vaccines. I mean, we have never had a coordinated worldwide effort with 107 vaccine candidates, 12 of them in human trials. Every rule that can be broken is being broken. Normally it takes 4 to 5 years to do these kinds of trials. They're running them simultaneously. They're running digital trials, computer trials, and human trials all at the same time. So every FDA in the world is breaking every rule they can, right? And I'm fine with that. I mean, right now, good luck. I mean, break every rule that you can. If the end result is the damn thing that you in works, fine. And yes, the people that are in those trials are taking risks, but you're saving millions of life on the other end by taking risk with some people in trials. So I'm very much in favor of this kind of aggressive break the rule, you know, process that we are seeing now. There's the Indians thing that they have a candidate. They're already making millions of copies of it while they wait for approval. Nobody makes millions of copies if they're not confident. The Cambridge group thinks that they have another one. I don't know. I'm not investing in these. Bottom line is, with a dozen candidates, only one of them has to work, mm-hmm. right? And also, everyone's ramping up. Everyone knows that billions of copies of these ampules have to be made. So I think that by the time we get to a viable vaccine, we will also have the production capacity to deliver it. And also, people are like, yeah, Neal, but it takes a while to make 7 billion copies. The answer is no, it doesn't. The key is, if we could just make enough to take the 10% of our population that is the most hurt by this and vaccinate those people, right? And we're not even talking about 7 billion, because the truth is, I mean, in a world that is a capitalist world, the United States is going to get its portion far before Namibia does or Kenya does. We're going to get our piece first, right? So it's just that's the way it is, because the vaccine is going to be expensive when it comes out, and the price will drop as more doses become available. Bottom line is, if you get 50 million doses, this whole thing's over, because the young people don't seem to care about COVID anyway. The ones that are caring because they have older parents or grandparents, and the grandparents were okay, that'd be fine. The world would go back to normal, and we could all take 6 months getting our vaccinations. So I have a very bullish feel for Q2 of next year, but Q4 of this year, Q1 of next year, who knows? I mean, we had 50,000 cases in the United States yesterday. We get to 100,000, we will start shutdown procedures for a number of states. Who knows? I mean, you're invested in Phoenix, and that's one of the hotspots now. For a while, Phoenix was doing really well. Now it's a hotspot. So you have no idea where Phoenix is going to go from here. I'm invested in Tucson, right? It's like, who the heck knows?
Yep. Okay, so let's talk about some opportunities now. You mentioned long-term multifamily. You may have mentioned industrial as well. But where do you see opportunities coming out of this?
Well, that depends on your risk tolerance, right? So what are you interested in? The first opportunity that I don't hear enough people talking about it is, have you seen that stabilized multifamily, the Fannie Mae loans are available at 2.8% for 10-year fixed?
I was just told 2.89 today.
Is that the most insane thing? 2.8% for locking in a 10-year fixed loan. So the first opportunity is actually the simplest one. Find enough investors and convince them that it's ridiculous to be holding a cash flowing asset today at 2.8%, and tell them it's going to take you a while to get to cash flow. But once you get to cash flow, there's no freaking downside. You're going to sit on this thing until the very last day of that 10 years. Because why in God's name would anybody need to sell a business when its mortgage was at 2.8%?
All right.
So I think the simplest opportunity is also the most obvious one, and it's very widely available. I mean, imagine the number of stabilized properties in the United States that you could buy. It's just gigantic, right? Huge numbers of properties are available if you don't have to do bridge. Downside, you have to convince investors that the cash flow is going to be pretty poor for the first 2 or 3 years. And I think this is a great time to convince investors, simply because they don't have a lot of choices. I mean, practically the crowdfunding portals are shut down too. They have like one project in a month where they used to have two in a week. So choices are low. So the number one opportunity is the one that is staring us in the face. Just go buy good property, get a 10-year fixed, convince your investors to take 5% cash flow. And haggle like hell, because it's not like there's a lot of buyers in the marketplace, so sellers don't have a lot of power. You've got the power. Haggle like crazy. You can't get a bridge loan on it though, right? Because the bridge is going to mess you up, right? Today, the moment you go into bridge loan territory, you're doing all kinds of bad stuff, which is why I'm not going there. But I don't mind looking at these 10-year loans and just sitting on them for 10 years, right? What's the worst that can happen? The price goes up like crazy. We're doing phenomenally well. Fine, pay $1 million prepay penalty. If you're making $6 million of profit and paying $1 million in prepay, that's still $5 million of profit, right?
Yep.
Makes sense. So I think that's the biggest one. I don't hear anybody talking about it. It's like, isn't this the most obvious opportunity? Don't you want to buy stabilized assets at 2.8%? Nobody would ever let you buy them before. They're letting you buy them now. And the pricing is also not very high. None of that nonsense $200,000 on day one crap that we have all gotten used to. Today, you can do your 15-day due diligence before you go hard on money. So you're actually in a pretty decent place. There's only one thing to do: convince investors to take low cash flow in the first couple of years.
Yep.
That's the 800-pound gorilla of opportunities.
Yep. How about markets? I mean, you're the data scientist that switches markets based on all the data that you're coming in. So where do you see the next couple of years happening in?
So I've always been very aggressive on fundamentals. I've always believed that the fundamental strength of an economy will show in a bad time. I've had a number of people that have said, you know, and I hate using Detroit as an example because it's a great city, but people have come to me and said, but there's a lot of money to be made in Detroit. I don't think that you see the potential. And my answer has always been, of course, there's lots of money to play in Detroit, but Detroit's like musical chairs. The moment the music stops, everybody sits down at the same time. And guess what happened? In the last 3 months, Detroit has seen the worst, you know, implosion. One quarter of the city is unemployed. The only city that's worse than Detroit is Las Vegas. Obviously, there's tourism economy. So that's an odd case. But when you're looking at major non-tourism based economies, you can see how Detroit was the weakest economy before. And people are saying, no, there's huge amounts of money to be made there. Let's buy, assets are cheap. Look at those people now. I mean, 25% unemployment. I know what's going to happen. There's going to be a wave of, of bankruptcies filed in the next 6 months there. I've been bullish on certain economies, and those I'm not bullish on anymore. I was bullish on Honolulu because in my course, I teach people that there's a website that called weareapartments.org, and it shows you just how difficult it is to do new construction in every market in the US. And there's this little graphical slider on weareapartments.org. And the city of Honolulu was all the way to the right, which means they don't want any new construction in Honolulu. They're like, we're a resort place, we're already overcrowded, don't build anything, please, right? So for a while, I was very bullish on Honolulu. I was like, wow, if you can make something happen there, no competition, right? Huge entry barrier. But at the moment, I think that the travel industry is going to be very hurt, but not across the board. So I wouldn't go to Honolulu. I wouldn't go to San Francisco because most people don't know this, but San Francisco has 25 million visitors a year. So it's a major tourism destination. Those are all, fairly rich people that are spending a lot of money in San Francisco. Not a cheap place to go to. Hotel rooms are $400 a night, right? Or at least used to be. So San Francisco, I think Honolulu is going to get really badly affected. Miami for sure is a horrible, horrible market at this point in time. Stay away from all parts of Miami. And then you've got these economies that were fundamentally weak that we're seeing some, seeing challenges. So Connecticut, anything in Connecticut, New Haven, major areas like that. Philadelphia had weakness. There was underlying weakness and it was bubbly. A lot of people were buying in Philadelphia. And now you see massive impact from COVID because the foundation was weak. And then you've got some markets that were very bubbly in Florida, like Tampa. We're seeing a lot of challenges with Tampa. I wouldn't have picked it 6 months ago as a place that was weak, but we're seeing some challenges there. So some of it is because I'm informed by new data. I'm happy to say that I was, suggesting to people a year ago that Tampa was good, not 6 months ago. I was saying it was bubbly. So things have changed there, but the cities that are doing well post COVID are really the same ones before. Mm-hmm. With one exception, Las Vegas, because Vegas got really crushed by this, right? So Denver, Durham, North Carolina, Raleigh, North Carolina, Provo, Utah, they're all in the Forbes top 10 list of cities that are best positioned to recover from coronavirus, all in the top 10 list. Salt Lake City is in there. San Jose is in there for one very specific reason. A tech-heavy city always does well in a pandemic because people can continue to work from home. They're used to working from home, so nothing really changes for them. Tucson, unsurprisingly, is in the top 10 list as well. I didn't see Phoenix in there, though I would guess that Phoenix would do well because Phoenix is both a technology economy and a finance economy. Technology and finance are the two most resilient sectors in a pandemic. Those are the sectors that are doing well. Obviously, you've seen what's happening to the NASDAQ. I mean, NASDAQ's going crazy. It's actually higher now than it was pre-COVID. So that's amazing. Finance is the other sector that has had almost no layoffs, like 1 or 2% of layoffs. So those two sectors are very resilient. The third one is government, right? So that's obviously not one that Phoenix is very strong at. But, Sacramento is pretty strong at government. So I'm sure it'll do well. So I would say Phoenix would do well, but secondary markets are doing better because people want to run away from density. Mm-hmm. And while Phoenix's density is much lower than, let's say, San Francisco, right? It's still fairly dense. So give me a second. Hang on. Am my kids are in a vicious gaming mode right now.
No worries.
So bottom line is that it's still the same cities. There's one other one that I would, you know, pick on. I would say Orlando is going to get hurt really badly, because what we saw was domestic tourism has bounced back very quickly. So if you look at Airbnb listings in Charleston, South Carolina, they bounced back very quickly because people took international expensive vacations and turned them into vacations that they could drive to. So everybody that lives in Raleigh or Charlotte is driving to Charleston, South Carolina, because it's, you know, it's a 4-hour drive. You get there and you enjoy the benefits of Charleston's marvelous weather. We're seeing the same thing across the board. We're seeing Coeur d'Alene filled up with Spokane tourists. So we're seeing that you know, tourism places that are 2, 3, 4 hours driving time from major metros are all of a sudden Airbnbs doing really well. But the ones that had exposure to international tourism, and Orlando is at the top of that list, they had 25 million international tourists, that is going to suffer for a long time, because we have this patchwork of countries deciding we're not going to let Americans in, we're not going to let, you know, people from Europe in, all kinds of nonsensical stuff. So it's international travel that's really hurting. So Orlando, I don't think it's a good pick for the next year.
Okay. So what's one thing Neal Bawa has learned through this COVID-19 situation? I know we're still in the very beginning of it, but, you know, what's one thing you've learned?
I think I learned something, or relearned something that I already knew. Black swan events are simply impossible to predict, and the impact that they'll have is impossible to predict. Mm-hmm. Even if, what I've learned is that on March 1st, or let's say Feb 1st of this year, you told me about COVID and you went through time, found a bunch of newspaper articles and web articles and transported them back to me on Feb 1st and showed them to me what COVID was going to do, I still would have no clue what it would do to multifamily. I mean, mm-hmm. This is truly an event that has had no precedence. There's no way to look at the past and understand it. So what this tells me is that despite me being cautious, I was a little bit over bullish on the market. I was like, you know, I thought 2020 was going to be a recession. Now it looks like the market's actually strengthening. I don't think there's going to be a recession. So you get complacent. And what you learn from these sorts of things is that just as you think that you're doing well, you're going to get knocked on your ass. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's really what happens. It's just, you know, everything just changes in a second.
Yep.
That's awesome. What I'm learning.
Lalita's going to take us into our final four questions. Are you ready?
Yeah.
All right, Neal, here we go again with the final four. What is the one tool you use in real estate investing that you could not do without?
I think for me, it has to be Neighborhood Scout. What I'm finding is that this tool saves me an absolutely insane amount of time when I'm looking at properties, because I get hit with a lot of properties. I unfortunately get hit with a lot more junk than you know, diamonds. And it saves me an insane amount of time. So I suggest you look it up. It's about $40 a month.
Can you tell us a story about your biggest mistake in real estate investing? And what is the main takeaway for our listeners?
Biggest mistake. Boy, there's a big menu to choose from. So I'd have to say it was our Chicago property. We bought that a while back and still struggling with it. I think that property had insane amount of potential with Tiger Woods building a golf course on the other side of the street, with the Obama Presidential Library being built 300 yards away, and a $2 billion massive project being built a mile down south where they had already invested $55 million, right? So you look at all of these and you go, yeah, this area is depressed, but with all of these happening, I can't lose. Mm-hmm. That's wrong. Never buy, because all three of those projects had trouble. President Obama's library got delayed by 4 years because of the Friends of Jackson Park, who threw some kind of frivolous suit, and eventually they lost. And so now the library is about to get built, but we've had, you know, pain and suffering for 4 years. Tiger Woods said, I'm Obama's friend, so I'm going to wait for him to build the library first before I build the golf course. And the $2 billion guys just went away, right? And we were left with an asset that was low quality, and all the good things that were happening either didn't happen or got delayed. Don't make that bet. Too many people are buying assets based on some future event happening. I learned that you shouldn't be using other people's money to make that bet.
Great advice. What is it that you need to do now to grow your life to the next level?
Very interesting question, right? I feel like in the last 2 years, I've asked myself that question so much that everything that I wanted to do, I've done. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to give you a weird answer. I'm at the point in my life where I don't feel that need. And it's nice to be there, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And lastly, Neal, where can people find out more about you?
Multifamilyu.com. We do a lot of deep dive webinars, not just on multifamily. We did one on industrial that we had 1,300 people sign up for a couple of weeks ago. So every asset in real estate, deep dive webinars, they're usually 50 minutes of true content, actual, rich, high quality content. And then we usually go another 40 minutes on questions. So we use every webinar that I've done in the last 6 months on MultifamilyU, we've had to stop at the 75-minute mark because the questions never stop. Mm-hmm. We did webinars for COVID. We do a town hall for COVID. We do that once every 2 to 3 weeks, and we update people. We've done 6 of these that we brought in experts from the industry. Over 10,000 people signed up for those 6 town halls. And so we've been very, very happy doing them. The only challenge is I don't have the money to buy Zoom licenses for more than 500 people. Yeah. So, but we do record them, and people, more than 1,000 people watch them on YouTube after the fact. So you go to YouTube and you'll see all the town halls, and you'll see that more than 1,000 people have watched each of those. So multifamilyu.com is really the best way to get in touch with us. My email address is really easy. It's Neal, N-E-A-L at multifamilyu.com.
Well, Neal, that was such a great episode. You've always been so gracious to us with your time and knowledge, and we really appreciate you being on our show again.
Thanks, guys. Thank you for bringing me on again.